Okay.
Oh.
How's it going, man?
Everything is great. How about you?
I'm good. I had some stir fry. I'm powered up. I'm ready to go.
Had tacos. It's Tuesday. We are we are creatures of habit around here. When you have little kids, when you start Taco Tuesday, you cannot deviate from Taco Tuesday, which is fine. I mean, you know, who needs a deviation from Taco Tuesday?
But like, do you guys have a like Monday's this, Tuesday's this, Wednesday's meatloaf?
Yeah. It's just, I mean, it's easier to keep it sort of regimented with kids. Mm-hmm. And also, you know, with the fact that we are now full-time school teachers, yeah. You know, you just, you just don't have time to think about it. But what we do on Fridays and Saturdays, Thursdays, Fridays and Saturdays is, you know, hey man, take out. And now, you know, with everybody having to do it out of necessity, but also it's easier because you could do it online and go pick it up. So, you know, we're scratching that itch to not have to cook, but also to help out, you know, the local restaurants and all that kind of stuff. So, you know,
that's cool.
Life in a pandemic, man.
Yeah, totally. Well, for everybody who's watching and will watch later, this is Rod Brooks.
Hi.
Hi. Rod Brooks is a friend of mine. We work together at KNBR, and Rod is afternoon drive. He's on 2 to 6. But Rod is the reason why I have a connection with Rod is because Rod loves music, and he loves music from, you know, he walks in with Public Enemy shirts. He walks in with Pearl Jam shirts. And I don't know, how many band tees do you think you have?
Dozens. I could see my, like my wife was just last night, because Sunday, or not last night, 2 nights ago, because Sunday is laundry day and night. And she's like, all your shirts are black. All your t-shirts are black. They're all basically all just, you know, band t-shirts. So I'm looking at my closet right now, at least like dozens, over 2 dozen, without a doubt.
And now that's not as many sneakers as you have, because you've also talked about your shoe collection.
Yeah, I got a problem. I got a sneaker problem. It's born. I mean, you know, my dress, when you did actually dress to go outside, is born out of the fact that I am in a suspended state of adolescence, arrested development. And
wait a minute, you too?
Yeah. Oh, I know I'm not alone. I'm just, you know, I'm in it, and I don't have any plans to get out of it. And sneakers go along with that. And, you know, just when you grow up, you don't have anything, and sneakers are the deal. And all of a sudden now you got a little bread in your pocket. Like, well, I'm a grown man. Why not fulfill, you know, that hole from my childhood? It's
the only hole that I feel in my life with shoes, because I just got Tevas, so that kind of filled the sandal hole. But then, but my parents never got me those shoes that light up. You know, like when you step.
Yeah. Oh, sure. Yeah.
I wanted that shit.
And I want. You know what? You're not ready to pull the trigger as an adult to have light up shoes. Come on, you don't have to grow up. It's okay. You're in a band.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah, I'll wear Converse forever. Well, okay. So, I wanted to talk to you because we just put out our double single "Patriots," and one of the. Oh, thanks, man. Thanks. And hopefully people are digging it. They seem to be, but, you know, it's out in the world, you know. One of the songs is called "Here Come the Cops." And before we finalized the idea of releasing it, I called some people who I knew were music fans or entertainers. I had talked to you about the second wave of the Black Lives Matter movement before, so I felt like I could come to you and you know, I know you didn't have to do that and talk to me about it. So I guess, first of all, I just wanted to say thanks, you know?
Well, I mean, it goes back, you know, well, you're welcome. But I was, and still am, was just floored and honored that you would ask, you know, my opinion, you know, about your music, which is obviously you're putting this out in the world, but it's very personal to you and obviously very personal to your bandmates. So to solicit my opinion about the music and then, you know, the subject matter too, I'm still blown away that my input, for lack of a better way of putting it, you wanted, you solicited, and you valued. So I mean, I'm happy that I can be of service in that regard, because, you know, I heard the demo and I know how important it is to you and to your band to get it right. Obviously, the importance of the subject matter goes without saying, and I'm happy to help, man, because, you know, if there's one thing we've figured out over these last few months, is that we need to talk, and more importantly, we need to listen.
Right.
To everything.
Right. Yeah. And I guess there are just a couple of things in our conversation that stood out to me. So basically, I know that Rod loves rock and roll. And since that's what we do, I thought I'd get his opinion on rock and roll. And I also was asking a group of my black friends, because as a white artist, like you said, Rod, I wanted to get it right, but I wanted to get it right because, you know, of course there's no way that a white singer or a white band can understand the struggle of what it means to be black in America. Never, but we can try to be the best allies that we can be, because we know that it's white people who need to change.
Yep.
And I think it's also important for white bands to talk to their audience and say, like, this is where we're coming from. Time to move ahead and come along with us. And I thought one of the things that stood out to me in our conversation when I played it for you is that, you know, I decided to go ahead and actually say the names of Breonna Taylor, Rashard Brooks, and George Floyd. And I wasn't sure about that because I didn't know if it was my place to say those names in a song. And I remember you said, man, I hope that those are the new names, that those names become the new Thomas Jefferson, Abraham Lincoln, like the new forefathers, like that we build a new nation on that. I thought that was incredible. That was really insightful and really cool, you know.
Well, again, thank you. I just, to me, those names need to be said, and they need to be said by everybody. So obviously, we don't forget, you know, that they're, you know, their lives are taken from them, obviously, but that they don't die in vain. And you know, you were ahead of the curve because, you know, with my brain being sort of a sports brain. You know, the NBA, you know, when they started back up and guys were figuring out what they wanted to put on the back of their jerseys, one of the things they had is either say her name for Breonna Taylor or say their names for, unfortunately, all of the people that were murdered by law enforcement officers. Because, again, it's important for those names to be said. And now, you know, in the NFL, now that they've started on the back of their helmets, they have the names or they have say their names that phrase on the back of their helmets. It needs to be said. We need to talk about them because they are important figures, and they can't get just kind of swept into the dustbin of history. And unfortunately, that happens because there are so many of these names. It is so commonplace, no matter what the other side tries to tell you. It is unfortunately so commonplace that people of color are murdered by police officers, and justice is not served, we just forget about it. You know, it just, it, I know that this isn't a law enforcement officer killing an unarmed black person, but now I'm going to use it anyway. Like, you forget about Trayvon Martin. Mm-hmm. It's crazy. You forget mm-hmm. about Trayvon Martin. Mm-hmm. And he should never be forgotten about. Or, you know, the names that don't get the public nationwide attention. So, I wanted to, when you asked me, you know, I wanted to make a point to let you know, just you're soliciting my opinion, you know, as a black man in this country. No, man, you know, you and the Foxes, you guys are allies. No, say those names. And if people listen to the song and they listen to it in a genuine way, they know you guys are not using those names to illegitimately just to kind of burnish the song. You're not throwing those names out there for shock value. Let's put it that way. I think that's the best way to put it. You're not throwing those names out there because, well, this is the part where you throw in these names of these three, unfortunately, because of their murders, these popular names. You did that, I felt, and obviously still feel, genuinely, because you didn't want those names to be forgotten, and they shouldn't be. So, you know, to know that you did it, like I said, from a genuine place, like, yeah, man, you got a right to say it because you're just as pissed off and angry and as sad and maybe, you know, someday soon as hopeful as, you know, right. I am, people who think like us are.
Are you personally hopeful, Ron?
I am. But I think it's more of my personality. It's got to get better, right?
Right. Yeah.
It's got to get better. I don't know if it'll ever get to a point where it's going to stop, but it's I'm hopeful, man. Just cause, you know, this past summer and maybe what is to come, but especially this past summer, it was a movement. And it was a movement that wasn't just people who look like me, it was people who look like us and other races, creeds, colors, or whatever. And it was a worldwide movement as well. So I'm hopeful because this thing can't be stopped. And now people know, you know, and I know we'll get into some songs, some protest songs, you know, what was, you know, 30 years ago with NWA or Public Enemy, you know, they were saying this stuff and people were like, oh, really? Is that happening? But they didn't pay attention. Now here we are, and because of technology and you know, the continuing murder of unarmed people of color by law enforcement, people who grew up on that music or who knew that music 25, 30 years ago now are going, mm-hmm. oh, okay. You know, it's all, right. you know, it's all coming together, I think.
Yeah. Who would have thought that Fuck the Police would be kind of like, oh yeah, from NWA.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I mean? It's like
we went from like, yo man, you can say that about the cops, to yeah, fuck them.
Well, and also, you know, I've said this to our fan base before too. You know, I'm not anti-police, but all police are caught in a system that is racist. So whether they are racist or not, they're caught inside of this system. Yeah. They're trying to do a lot of cops are trying to do the right thing, but it's set up.
But they ain't. No, but they ain't. This is the part that pisses me off.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah.
Is that the law enforcement community expects and demands at times our loyalty, our implicit, unwavering trust, and they expect for us to be truthful with them at all times. Hey, just tell me where you're going, just tell me what you're doing, just tell me if you got something on you, and you know what, just tell me, don't lie to me. They expect all of these things from us, but they don't give any of that back. You dig what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You're not trustworthy with us. You are not honest with us a lot of times. You are, you know, cops always say, just tell us who the bad people are and we'll go get them.
Yeah.
cops. Just tell us who the bad cops are and let them be dealt with in the justice system that you put that you put people in. You have politicians on your side. You have other than the Major League Baseball Players Association, you have the strongest union in the country. You have the judicial system on your side. You have all of these built-in advantages. You have pop culture. That's starting to change a little bit, but you have pop culture, and you see all of these advantages. You have all of these perks, yet you don't give us anything, but you demand for us to respect you, but you don't respect us. That's what pisses me off. So when I hear this whole, well, there are some good cops. Hey, man, if you are a part of a system that allows terrible people to do terrible things with the might of the United States government and its judicial system behind them, then you just as bad as them. So that's what bugs me as a black male adult in this country, is that you want us to do right by you, but you don't do right by us. Well, then you know what? I got to lump you all together, because you know what you do? You lump all of us together.
Right.
You fit the profile. Yeah, that's what they say to us, right? We something was suspicious. Somebody looks like you. They gave a description. Somebody looked like you. This is the same fantasy. This shit happens. It's happening right now. They look like you. Well, you know what? To all the cops out there, you might not be a bad cop, but you fit my description.
Well, and like you were talking about the protection of these bad cops and or cops that who have been fired for being caught on tape doing unbelievable things, and then they just move to a different precinct, and then they get hired.
That's bananas, isn't it?
It's insane, and we have the power to vote for people who will write laws. I think they will now. I think now that there's public pressure, but right, but we have the power to vote for the right people who can write laws that will stop this migration and the protection, as you say, of other cops. And yeah, absolutely. I totally agree with that.
I mean, it's like, you know, wrong is wrong. It's like the Catholic priest that, right? You get caught doing something that is just completely and totally reprehensible. You just move to another parish. Like, that's ridiculous. You abuse your powers as a law enforcement officer, and you could just go three towns over and get another job to do it again. Like, come on, man. Right. it's mind bending.
Yeah. Well, thank you for saying that, and
it came off my chest.
You know. Well, no, that's awesome. No, I mean, I really appreciate that, and I think I kind of want to talk a little bit about the music side of of some of these protest songs that we're going to listen to. That was another thing that you mentioned to me when we talked about Here Come the Cops, was that punk rock mentality, that intensity, that visceral intensity. I think a lot of, you know, it seemed right and fitting, but I will say, I mean, of course, white people can never understand the visceral, like that intense emotion. And I know that you've told stories on KNBR about you being profiled here in the North Bay, and that intensity and what that must feel like to that pressure. And I think sometimes music can translate as that urgency and that intensity.
Yeah, it's interactions with the police, and I've had minimal over the course of my life, but what I remember from them, that visceral feeling, is that everything is just sped up. Everything is just, it's just intense. It just seems like the conversations are faster. It just seems like everything is just intense. That's just the best way I could put it. Even if and a lot of the times the last interaction I had, the officer was very calm. I was very calm, but it just felt sped up, you know what I mean? And I think of, some of my favorite songs, some of my favorite protest songs. And protest songs obviously come in, they of a wide variety of sounds or tempos, I guess
Total.
is the best way to put it. But I, the ones that I guess resonate with me, maybe that's just, just kind of where my head is that, but the ones that kind of have that sense of just that sense of urgency, the visceral interaction between someone who feels that they did nothing wrong, and they probably didn't do anything wrong, but you feel threatened, and then the person who's got all the power on the other side, who's just kind of just, measuring you up, and just, is this person a threat? Or they come to you just because they see you and they see your skin color or whatever, and they automatically perceive you as a threat, because you are black or because you are of color. So it just that, that sort of audio cue of when you just hear that intensity or the intensity of a certain song that is about protest, protesting whatever. That just always just resonates, that just always just resonates with me. And you are a sum total of your life experiences, and that probably has to do with my experiences, albeit limited, but experiences nonetheless with the cops.
Right. Well, how about let's play a little bit of Here Come the Cops, and then we'll start
Yeah,
jumping
man.
into. Say it again.
No, just like
What's
right on,
that?
let's go.
Yeah, let's
Rock
do
and
it. Let's do
roll.
it real quick. Okay. Because we're here to play. We gotta get don't bore us, get to the chorus, as Tom Petty used to say. So but no, I mean the conversation is the whole point. But yeah, let's see if I can get this to run here. Let's see. There we go. Let me get this guy going. Oh. Hold on, Rod. Hold on, Rod.
Your sound changed.
Yeah. It certainly did. Hold on, let's see. We're going home. We're going to Rod's playlist. And then I want to play this song. Huh. Okay. How do I change this? I'm sorry, Rod, just a moment.
I got nowhere to go. I'm at home, so.
Oh, okay. Oh, wow. What the hell? I'm sorry, just a
Is
moment.
that a God commercial? That's right.
Yeah, I think I'm trying to get to my to my account, and okay, home. I'm sorry, everybody. Just a second. I thought I had it all planned out here. You know what? I'm really sorry, Rod. I'm having some difficulty with this. Let me see. I thought, here, I'm going to do this. And I'm going to go, and the cops. Wow. Well, it might not go over. Shoot.
Technology. Oh,
I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. Yeah, technology sucks. You know, how about this? How about maybe we just do you want to just talk about some of our songs?
Sure.
Just a few of them? Okay, cool. And I will try to get this working out a little bit. But Yeah. So you made a list for me, and it was I asked for 3, you gave me 7, which is fabulous. And then
Oh, sorry. No.
I was like, oh man, he can't help it. He loves it. Let's see. And that first one was
Well, I can narrow it down.
You go ahead to
3. And the first one I gave you was one that came from 1990, and it's shout out my hometown, Houston, Texas, the Ghetto Boys, and their album, their self-titled album, which was produced by Rick Rubin, by the way.
Yeah.
And at the end of the album is a song called City Under Siege. And it is one of my favorite songs, just period. But it's the song that really, for the first time, it clicked in my brain just in terms of the world as I knew it as a kid, a teenager. It's different as I was going into adulthood. So in 1990, I was 19 years old and a freshman in college. And so the song, it's Ghetto Boys song, and so there's a lot in there, but there's a few things in there that really, like I said, it flicked a switch in my brain, and I felt like I started to see things differently. First and foremost, there's a line in there. They talk about the relationship between Ronald Reagan, George Bush, and Manuel Noriega. And basically what it is I can hear. Yeah, I can hear.
Yeah. Okay, so, now we're going.
They talk about the relationship between these guys. Born in the ghetto, I was street thug. At age 16, I started selling cheap drugs. Ecstasy would cost you 3. A year later, I robbed the dope house and stole the key. 36 is what I count. Now multiply 36. It's about the drug game, because it's the ghetto.
Yeah.
But what they talk about it, the song, well, how did they get the drugs? Listen.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, talking about the Reagan policies.
That blew my mind, because what they're saying there is that, wait a minute, where are the drugs coming from?
Right.
And now we know, you know, that we're years from that time, that the Black community was being flooded with cocaine, with crack cocaine, and by the CIA, by the federal government. Where was this coming from? This was coming from Central America. It was coming from South America. How was it getting here? It was all getting here through Panama. Black people all of a sudden didn't start to go get cocaine from Latin America and bring it in and start selling it. It had to get there somewhere, and it came there from the government. When I heard that, it was just like, oh shit, that's right. And then talking about law enforcement, like the same people, you know, that are stopping the bus are the same ones that deliver to us. Like the cops are telling, they would use drug dealers to say, you tell us about your rival selling dope, you'll go bust them, but you got to pay our protection money. Like, holy smokes. You hear that at 19 years old after watching, you know, after growing up during the Just Say No era and watching crack just tear up my neighborhood, you know, the South Side, Sunnyside, and South Acres. 19 years old, that just blew my mind. And there's also another line in that song. There's a lady named Ida Delaney who worked the graveyard shift at the local newspaper. And she was leaving work at like 5 o'clock in the morning, and she got into an altercation with these 3 off-duty police officers that were drunk. They basically chased her down and they shot her. And they got off because they were police officers. And that was the first time that I put the connection between not all police officers are good. Right. And the system works for them and it doesn't work for us. Ida Delaney could have been my grandmother. Ida Delaney could have been my aunt coming home from work, yet these three, can I cuss on here? These three asshole cops were drunk, they killed her, and they got away with it. And so that was my first awakening. So, you know, in terms of like seeing things differently. And this is post NWA and Fuck the Police and Public Enemy Fight the Power. But this is the song that awakened me because they were talking about real stuff in this song that we now know is absolutely true in terms of the drug trade and how the drugs got into the black community and the fact that cops can kill people and because they're protected, they get away with it. I heard that at 18 years old, blew my mind, still blows my mind.
Well, and I think when you were a kid at 19, the dialogue around hip-hop was I think it was almost the same as it was almost 10 years ago, where you know you still heard a lot of white people saying, oh, it's just about having sex, you know, it's like talking down on this art form that has been speaking truth for years and years and years. And that's part of the problem is the demonizing of hip hop and black culture when it's like white people are stealing black culture all day. And anyway.
Yeah. Or did you just say all the stuff that's being talked about, it's not true. You're making that up. It's fabricated.
Right.
Or you're blowing it out of proportion. No, man, ain't nobody blowing nothing out of proportion. That's all true. That song is 30 years old, and it's still relevant today as you know, it was back when it came out, to me anyway.
Yeah. Well, I think we got the sound figured out.
Let's hear the song. God.
Just a little late, Rod, but it's fine. It's totally fine. Yeah,
I like it. It's got that sense of urgency, man. Like I said, it just, you know, it's, I guess my own personal taste, it appeals to me, but it's got that urgency, man. It really does.
Yeah. Well, and that's what it takes is, I mean, every time that there's ever been major change, it takes that incredible sense of urgency. And I know everybody knows this, but God, you know, COVID sucks for a shitload of reasons, but it sure has sort of cleared all the bullshit away and given us some tunnel vision a little bit.
Yep. You can't help but be focused on what's going on because you have basically nothing else to do except focus on what's going on. What choice do you have?
I just sit here. Yeah. Well, it's been, you know, my brother's doing all that guitar work, and it's fuzzy as hell, man. And he really wanted to. I think we finally found the right tone. It was cool. I had a conversation with the vocal director at the Oakland School of the Arts. Her name is Kava Menzies. Mm-hmm. And she had amazing insight. And I had some lyrics after Eric Garner died, which was the first wave of the Black Lives Matter movement.
Again, another name, and just like people remember, but they kind of don't remember because there have been so many.
Right. Another man who, choked and was choked and murdered. And so I had these lyrics after that, because how could you not feel and emote? And that's what musicians do. We write about those emotions. And so I had a draft, and I was thinking about putting those lyrics on there, but I thought that they needed a lot of work. And I was talking to Kava, and I said, is that if I don't use some of these older lyrics, does that make them not as legitimate or not as honest? Like, if I, and she said, no. What white people need to do is continue to revise your history, and that is the most, not your history, revise what you're doing, and revise how you say things, and revise your approach, because that is the most honest thing you can do.
Yeah.
Right, exactly. Yeah, and so that was kind of, that felt really freeing, to feel like
nice.
I wasn't chained to an old set of lyrics or old emotion about something. I could experience it in a new way. It was kind of an amazing thing. But
yeah.
Okay.
I mean, that must, what you guys do is just as artists and lyricists and songwriters, it must be freeing to know that somebody kind of gets it and understands it, and just kind of unlock you from your own sort of inside your own head. Like, am I doing this right, or is the right thing? Like, when you kind of get that affirmation, it just must be unbelievable.
Well, it wasn't even affirmation. It was like, this is what you should do, And I can't thank her enough for that guidance, which is, pretty incredible. But okay. All right. Other tunes. Okay. We're narrowing it down, because then I pick seven. So I got to stick to three, because we'll never get out of here.
So I'll go with, do I get to pick? Should I pick?
You go ahead. Yeah, you're up.
I'll go with the obvious, or one of the obvious ones. Fight the Power. Public Enemy is along with the Who and Nirvana. Public Enemy is my favorite group of all time. They mean so much to me. I've learned more about Black history from Chuck D than I did, and I have from the public school systems in Texas and Louisiana. Strangely enough, those two places
are
lacking on Black history. I wonder why. Man, Fight the Power was just. No, go ahead.
Oh, I was just saying, I didn't want to gloss over what you just said, that you learned more from Chuck D than you did from any school system. I think that is incredibly important, because it's a lot of the same things that are being taught right now in school, too.
Yeah. It is sad, obviously, that's a fact for me in my life, but it is also a testament to Chuck D and to Flavor Flav too, but obviously specifically Chuck D, is that I don't know if it was a part of his mission or if it just came out. It's probably a combination of the two, but I know I'm not the only one that feels that way and has that point of view. But there have been some songs where hip hop songs before Fight the Power that talked about what's going on. Fuck the Police came out before Fight the Power. The Message, obviously, which to me is the greatest rap song of all time, because it showed hip-hop's potential. in terms of it could actually tell you about what's going on in inner city America and what's going on with Black people. And I think hip hop realized, you know, what that dream sort of that the message you're trying to put out there. But Fight the Power, because of the sound, the Bomb Squad and Chuck D's voice and the lyrics and the movie, obviously, Do the Right Thing. But that video goes hand in hand with the song, just to see all of those Black people marching through Brooklyn. I felt like I saw my teenage face in those marches in that video, and it looked like what I saw, what I eventually saw from the 60s. You know what I mean? Which, you know, once we got past 68, the death of Martin Luther King, we kind of really didn't have Black people marching through the streets. It was almost like, you know, the struggle was over, when obviously that it wasn't. So to see that video along with this song, along with what's being said, I've seen them in concert a few times, and when they play it, you feel like you're at a protest march. You feel like you're at a rally. I mean, it stirs something inside of me every single time I hear it. And, you know, the message is just pretty simple. It's fight the power. You know, how do you fight who the power is? You don't even answer those questions. You just know it's strong and it's authoritative and it's all of those things. Yeah, you know who it is. And you know, for that to come out, you know, the hip hop is, you know, late 70s, but if you just call it from 1980 or 1982, from the message to 1989, Another Summer, you know, that was the hip hop's formative years, the golden era of hip hop. And we get to the end of that decade and you have this song taking us into the 90s. And obviously things changed, and I'm not saying it changed for the worse, but it changed. But yet here we are now in 2020, where that message, just like Fuck the Police, is still relevant. It's a timeless song, but it hit right off the jump. It hit me, you know, as a young Black man in 89, you know, 17, 18 years old, whatever I was, it just hit me in the right place. And it still does, man. It's the ultimate hip hop protest song. It really is. Yeah. And I don't think anybody's going to be able to do any better. It really does. Because they haven't yet.
No, it's already been, yeah. What? When did this song come out? What? When?
Summer of 89.
Oh my God.
Yeah, 1989.
Yeah. I mean,
it's 1989. Because it was, if you've seen Do the Right Thing, it is
as
big a part as the movie Do the Right Thing as the actors and the story. You hear that song over and from the beginning of the movie, when Rosie Perez is doing her dance with the boxing gloves on, to, you know, basically the end of the movie when Radio Raheem is murdered by the police. That movie that song Fight the Power is a massive part of that movie. It's iconic.
Yeah. By the way, if anybody is just jumping on, this is Rod Brooks. Rod Brooks is a friend of mine. He is a sportscaster on KNBR 680 104.5 in the Bay Area. He was so kind to talk with me about Here Come the Cops before we put it out. And we are just jamming on some protest songs that we love. I think I'm gonna go with a little old school, because that tends to be what I like to do for some reason. But I'll jump up to some Lil Wayne in a little bit. But I want to play Sinner Man by Nina Simone. And so let's make sure that gets up. I don't even really. Okay. I guess here's what I'll say about this. I think since Charlottesville, Rod, I think I was naive before Charlottesville in thinking that the old guard of hate groups, of white supremacy, of white nationalists, Proud Boys, all those unbelievable groups are, it was my impression that that was an old man thing, or like you were probably 40 years old or older if you were involved in that. And when I saw Charlottesville and all of those angry, bitter, disgusting young white men came down with their tiki torches, and they looked like me, and it really fucked with my head. And I thought, fuck, I thought we were better than this. I thought our generation was better than this, as far as the white people of our generation. And it's just clear that some of us aren't, and there's just as much work to do. And so I guess that's what I think of when I think of this song, you know. And I mean, that's the context for it now, for me anyway.
Well, you know what? You were not alone. There were a lot of people, and people of color, who kind of thought, nah, man, you know, there's still hate, and there's still hate groups in the Klan, it's still around or whatever. But you just thought, yeah, man, I mean, to put it this way, there are not enough of them, and those people can't hurt us. And what we found out with Charlottesville is that there are a lot of them. They are disturbingly young. And then when Dylan Roof came along and he walked into that church in South Carolina and committed the horrific mass murder that he committed, you went, oh yeah, they can hurt us too. And I don't know if it was like after Obama, or you know, the 8 years of Obama, and you're just like, you know what? Okay, racism is over, because it's that. No person of color thought that. No person of color brain thought that. But I think there was this idea that, okay, man, those old racist institutions, man, they got no sway, they got no power, they got, you know, they got. Nobody's checking for them, and then you find out, oh shit, they are. And then we get to where we are in this current political climate. You're like, oh, and they are still a part of this country from an institutionalized racism standpoint. You know, you're just like, oh fuck. So we really didn't we really didn't move anywhere. We're just kind of you know, we're hamster wheeling this thing.
Well, and nothing that's new here, and part of what's being brought up with Biden is the incarceration that was put into law by Biden and other people, you know, the Clinton administration. And I mean, we're talking about people being imprisoned just in a different way. I mean, it's the same, you know. They change the words, and how it looks, but it's the same thing in its own way.
Yeah. Incarceration is incarceration. I mean, it's still imprisonment, and there's just no way around that. It's not a good thing at all. You know, and hopefully Biden, you know, can atone for his past mistakes, but you know.
Just on a musical note, this right here. You know, Rod, I'm going to get a beer. I like that IPA idea. Everybody enjoy some Nina and Rod. I'll be right back. Yeah. Nina Simone, man, Jesus Christ. Here's my thing. Oh. Yeah. Well, this one's kind of a long one. We might go ahead, Rod.
No, I'm just saying, unbelievable. She's unbelievable. There's no two ways about it.
Yeah, I mean, we just did Public Enemy and Nina Simone. I don't know. I guess there's people worth playing after that. We'll find out. I think we could, you know, a long song. Why don't we? You're up next, Rod. Your pick next.
I have so many to choose from. You know what? I know where I'll go. Rage Against the Machine.
I was hoping you'd say that.
Because. I mean, some of those that work forces are the same that burn crosses. And again, this is, you know, this is mid to late 90s. I forget when this came out, but they're telling you then what the problem was then and what the problem is now, which is, and this kind of goes back to the conversation we were just having about the white supremacy groups. Where did they go? They couldn't be as overt as riding around town, burning crosses, and they couldn't do that. They had to go somewhere. They had to assimilate. And what white supremacists have done is they have, for years now, assimilated into law enforcement.
Right.
And that infiltration into law enforcement, which is, you know, already been there, but especially now, you know, over the past 50 years or so, that assimilation into law enforcement has been extraordinarily dangerous for people of color, because you have people that have power, that have, you know, as I talked about earlier, have the judicial system and politicians on a local, state, and national level in this country behind them, and they have their backing, and they hate people of color, and that has been a deadly combination for people in this country, Black people of color in this country, for far too long, and that's really what needs to change. And who knows how long it's going to take to fix that problem? But first, that problem needs to be identified by our politicians on a local, state, and national level, and then hopefully we can go from there. But they're telling you, Rage is, Klan members, white supremacists are cops. And they are in neighborhoods where there are people of color, and they are doing horrible, horrible, horrible things. And the fact that we haven't acknowledged it, we haven't dealt with it, and it is as bad of a problem now as it was back then when Rage was talking about it, it's chilling when you think about it, because there are people who hate people who look like me, who have the ability to incarcerate me, or worse yet, kill me, or people who look like me, just because they don't like me. But Rage is telling you sonically, with some incredible guitar, you know, from I'm blanking on his name, from Tom Morello, Zach's voice. But then at the end, they come out with just this primal scream of "fuck you, I won't do what you tell me." And is there anything more punk? Is there anything more protest than telling someone who is in a position of authority that shouldn't be there, "fuck you, I won't do what you tell me"? I don't know. It's brilliant in its simplicity and the anger that comes behind it. So that's the one I want to go with, is that, you know, that's Rates once again, man, speaking the truth, and they've been doing it for a long time, and people paid attention a little bit back then. People are paying attention a lot more now. But they per usual, man, they're right on the money. Rage don't miss, dude. Rage don't miss. When they say something, they are right on about it.
But they say it in a way, like, there's a lot of people who try to say what they mean, but shit, they just do it right. And there's, I mean, their sales, you know, I mean, people have been talking about Rage Against the Machine has sold more records this summer than ever, you know, but it's because, you know, their music just is so universal and speaks so loudly to everybody. I mean, that's one of my favorite shows I've ever seen. And, you know, there's white kids like me that were in the crowd. We were like, you know, Bulls on Parade, and we're like jamming out. We don't understand, you know, we can't understand, but shit, I think it's really important, like, that they fill us up with the energy and that rage to mobilize people. And that is a gift, man. That's crazy. Okay. Drop it.
I mentioned your song. I never got to see it, but I was going to this past spring because they were going back on tour after they did their Coachella thing.
Oh!
And got tickets for both the shows here in the Bay Area. Then, of course, COVID happened. I know, right? I know. But I'm glad they got back in the game. I don't know if they're going to put out any new stuff. God, I only hope so. But, man, the fact that they – because, man, we need them. We need them, dude. We need them bad. Yeah. So I'm so glad they got back in the game. I hate I haven't seen them. I'm jealous of your experience. And hopefully once we get out of this, man, hopefully they're still going to tour. Because they're like, you want to refund those tickets? Absolutely not.
Dude, I mean, so Zach has been guesting on Run the Jewels songs for a while. And so I was so excited to see Zach come on up with Killer Mike and just fucking kill it. I was ready, but they'll be back. They'll be back. Justified those that died, man. Fuck.
Wait, come on.
Damn. Damn. Yeah, that's amazing. Dude, okay, so you're also a drummer. That's a bad man on those drums, dude.
Oh, God. He's a beast.
A beast. Disgusting. Yeah. Okay. All right, we each get one more. I'm sorry, it's hard to turn it off.
I know, right?
People coming on our Facebook and seeing us like do this, I mean, they're like, oh, Jesus. That's okay. Well, they're used to me.
We're not the only ones doing it.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. Okay. Let's see. You know what? I'm gonna go with should we go old school or new school? Your call, Ron.
Give me something new. Give me something new.
Something newer. Okay. This isn't totally new, but it's definitely something that I've always loved listening to. It's like a this one is long too. I guess I've been picking all the long extended versions of everything. Let's see here. So this song's called Don't Get It from Lil Wayne on Carter 3. And it's, do you know this song?
Yes.
Okay. And what I love about it is the long conversation that he just has with his listeners at the end of that song, about their miseducation and how he still feels so misunderstood by so many of his fans and so many people who listen to his music, and even by leaders, some leaders in the Black community. And I just think it's, you know, he points out Al Sharpton and has some choice words for him, but it's just, it's very interesting to me to just like get Lil Wayne smoking a bowl and telling you how he feels about the state of things, you know?
Yeah.
And then of course he has Nina Simone help him out. But I just think this is a great song. Baby, you understand me now. If sometimes you see that I'm mad, don't you know no one alive can always be an angel? When everything goes wrong, you see some bad. But I'm just a soul whose intentions are good. Oh Lord, please don't let me be mad. Understood. Oh, what's understood, they gotta be explained. But you don't understand me, so let me explain. Stood in the heat, the flame, the snow. Please slow down, hurricane. The wind blow, my dread swing. He had hair like wool, like rain. Dropping ashes in the Bible. I shake them out and they fall on the rifle. Scary. Hail Mary, no tail fairy, all real fairy, ordinary parent, face and face it, the barrel of eternal. My God is my judge. No doubt. Anyway, and I guess I could fast forward to sort of, maybe I'll fast forward to that ending real quick.
Yeah.
So this is sort of his talking jam at the end.
Selling the crack cocaine is because we in the hood. And it's not like the suburbs. We don't have the things that you have.
Right.
Why? I really don't want to know the answer.
Yep.
But I guess we just misunderstood. Yeah. You know, we don't have room in the jail now for the real motherfuckers, the real criminals, you know, sex offenders. Rapists, serial killers, shit like that. Oh, don't get scared.
Yeah.
Don't get scared. I know you saw one of them sex offender papers. Don't trip. He live right on the end of your block.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, man. But yeah, I mean,
you forget how good of a lyricist he is. And I forget that he is 100% from New Orleans. And the people in New Orleans, especially Black people from New Orleans, they are different than any other Black people in the country. It's a whole different world down there. They have just a different way of speaking. They have a different way of speaking their mind. And, you know, because Lil Wayne is just so ubiquitous. Like I said, I forget how New Orleans he is, but I hear that and I'm like, yeah, man, that dude is from, you know, he's from, I forget if he was from 9th Ward or 7th Ward. I forget, but he's from one of the wards in New Orleans. Like, yeah, that he sounds like every dude that I know, you know, that I grew up with or that I ran across. I mean, when I still live down south, he sounds like every dude that I knew from New Orleans.
Oh, man. Yeah, I did. Do you feel like the music in New Orleans, do you feel like you have a connection to that? Because you grew up in Houston. Do you feel like your connection is more to the Houston scene? Because I know Houston's got, you know, a million artists from there. Or do you identify a little bit more with New Orleans since it's so close?
But this guy and people like him, they'd rather speculate before they implement.
No, what's funny is the Houston scene really did, like, there's the Ghetto Boys, and they're going to be royalty, but the Houston scene didn't really start to pop off until I moved out here to the Bay Area in the late 90s, and that's when you had the late DJ Screw, rest in peace, doing his thing, and that food and chop scene that he and you know, those guys like the Screwed Up Click and K Reno and I'm blanking all these names, and I should know them, and they should really be shouted out. So my apologies, Ace Town, for blanking names, but it's been a while. But anyway, that didn't start jumping off until the mid to late 90s, and I had already moved out here. So, you know, really for me, kind of my hip hop education is all just based on, yeah, because I can remember like when hip hop was new. Like I can remember hearing The Message for the first time. I can remember hearing Rappers in Life for the first time. I can remember hearing Sucker MCs by Run DMC for the first time. But all of that was coming out of New York. We didn't start to, like I said, the Ghetto Boys didn't come along until the mid to late 80s. And then obviously to the 90s when they came out with We Can't Be Stopped, and that's got Mind Playing Tricks on Me, which is their biggest song. But by the time, like I said, the Houston rap scene really exploded, mainly due to DJ Screw and Screw to Chop music. And you know, now you got Paul Wall. And obviously, shout out to UGK and Bun B and Pimp C. But, you know, they didn't really start to blow up until I had left. I had left the Third Coast. But yeah, man, I mean, you know, now they're just a big part of hip hop, you know, as obviously what New Orleans has done and put out, you know, with Wayne and Birdman and all that. And then obviously what Atlanta is doing. You can't forget Miami, right? Too, you know, what 2 Live Crew and specifically Luther Campbell put out there. But, you know, it just makes me proud because while they're all different, it just makes me proud as somebody from the South. Like, man, hip hop was just a New York thing, and it was just an LA thing. All of a sudden, in the South came up, and like, no, we're gonna throw this down. And really, when you think about it, like Southern hip hop, just that sound is the dominant paradigm in hip hop today, which is crazy when you think about it. It happened that fast.
Yeah. Well, man, dude, I think I need to go to the school of Rod Brooks. On, like, I feel like I've done some research on hip hop origins, but shit, that would be really fun to like come listen to some records, man. That would be really fun to listen to some of the like some different Houston artists. That would be super cool, dude. You and Polly and Tony and I, we doing old records. That'd be the best. These people probably don't know who they are, but that's fine. That's fine. Okay, Rod, last one. Your call.
Oh, Oh, man. Yeah, dude, when we can finally leave the house, we're going to have fun. So let me just shout out James Brown, Say It Loud, Black and Proud. That came out in 1968. That was a pretty radical thing, he was saying, pretty radical record he put out there. And for James Brown to do that is a little bit before my time. I wasn't born yet. But, man, James Brown was a superhero to the Black community. And so for him to do that for us at that time was a monumental thing. So I just want to shout that out. But I'm going to go with, obviously, you know, I'm going to go with Fuck the Police. You know, like we were saying earlier, you know, that, so that came out in 88. And I remember it was just like, you can say that about the police?
Right.
But you felt like when you turned it on, you were going to get in trouble. You know, it was that provocative. And, you know, they were again talking about real experiences and, you know, what they've gone through and what they were going through. But, man, to be able to have the balls to say that, in 1988.
That's
crazy. I don't.
Yeah.
What else do you say? Like they did that. They did. Dude. They had.
The authority to kill a minority, dude.
The United States government heard that and said, "Nah,
right.
Too hot."
That's bananas. Yeah, it is. It is amazing. I mean, yeah. And these guys were kids, man. You know, like, that's what's so amazing.
No lies there, and it's still just as true nowadays.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, it might be, I mean, when you think about protest songs or, you know, kind of speaking truth to power or telling, you know, authority figures to go kick rocks. Oh, that's another provocative line. Like, boy. But has there ever been a younger group to say something as provocative as that? I can't think of it.
I don't know. I don't think so. I think our delay.
And they just keep saying it.
Yeah.
That's the part about it.
Like, yeah.
It's the title of the song. Those are the first three words you hear in the song. And then it's a part of the hook. Like they put it in the mix. They scratch it in. They keep repeating over and over and over. Fuck the police.
Yeah.
They don't say FTP. They don't say forget the police. They say it from the beginning of the song until the end of the song. That's crazy.
Right. Well, that's their experience. I mean, that's like, you know, their experience with the police is violent, it's there is no safety, like you said at the beginning of our discussion. You know, you don't feel like you have that mutual respect. There is not a, you know, they're asking you for information, but you can't get their information. It's totally a one-way thing, and of course they're going to say that because that's the truth and that's their experience. But Well, I know our delay is a little fucked up, Rod, but I thought that we still had a awesome conversation, and I really appreciate again your time and hang out with you even through this COVID bullshit, and just for your truth and your personal take, and I can't thank you enough.
Oh, man. I'm blown away and just and overwhelmed, you know, that you think as highly of me as you do, and my opinion, and I hope that I, oh, what's the best way to put it? I hope that your trust in my opinion and my truth, and the knowledge I've gained from my experiences. I hope it. I hope you got what you wanted, and my respect for you, you know, doing something that, you know, secretly and, you know, in another life, or, you know, my Walter Mitty times, do I dream of doing what you do and being a rock star? Possibly. My respect for you and your talents is just off the chain, and I wish y'all nothing but the best with the new stuff and when this is all over, because I think I was supposed to come and see you guys before COVID shut down the world. I cannot wait to actually see you in concert.
Yeah, what the fuck, Rod? Where were you, Rod? No. Yeah, I know our delay is crazy, but thank you, my friend, and I'll talk to you soon. Okay. Thanks, everybody.
Bye.
Bye.